Hello, everyone. It's Wednesday, April 17th. I'm David Song, strategist with Forex.com, here for the weekly fundamental market outlook. And a lot going on, especially as we had some interesting comments from not only Federal Reserve Chairman Jerome Powell, but we also heard from Vice Chair Jefferson, and both officials largely arguing that recent data prints coming out of the U.S. not really providing the confidence that the Fed needs to start moving on interest rates. But before we jump into everything, just wanted to give everyone a minute to read the disclaimer. All right, so a bit of house cleaning before we get things started. As always, the material that we'll be covering today, my own personal opinion, not a recommendation from Forex.com. And for those of you that have joined through Forex.com, feel free to use the question as well as the chat box as we go through today's session. And before we jump into price action, again, we had some interesting remarks from Fed officials earlier this week. All after we saw some strong numbers earlier this month in regards to U.S. non-farm payrolls, U.S. consumer price index highlighting or revealing sticky inflation. So we'll see how the data progresses. But out of the U.K., just quickly overnight, we did see U.K. inflation also come in stronger than expected. Core inflation, 4.2% versus 4.1% expected. So we did see, again, a bit of a bullish reaction in the British pound. Headline inflation for the UK, 3.2% versus 3.1% expected. So we'll see, again, how this will all fare for the Bank of England going forward. The final reading for Eurozone inflation, confirming the core reading at 2.9%. And then we'll be watching the headlines later on this afternoon, as we'll be hearing from Bank of England Governor Andrew Bailey. Also, European Central Bank President Christine Lagarde will be on the wires as well. We'll see if we get anything interesting in regards to these speeches. Remember, the ECB has abandoned forward guidance for quite some time. So again, we'll see whether or not we get any remarks in regards to monetary policy. But later on this afternoon, the Fed will release their beige book. But where my focus is going to largely lie, especially as we wind down and go through the month of April, we have a lot of these Fed officials still scheduled to speak. So later on, later on today, we have Cleveland Fed President Loretta Mester, who is a voting member on the FOMC this year. She'll be speaking later on this afternoon. And don't forget, in her last speech, she was the one that talked about maybe we can see a higher neutral Fed funds rate, right? The R-star, if you will. A lot of officials have been talking about whether or not they need to raise the longer-term forecast for U.S. interest rates, especially given the performance of the U.S. economy. And then we'll have Governor Michelle Bowman also later on today. We'll be jumping into the IMF conference. And I do want to talk about some of the fresh forecasts coming out of the IMF, especially given some of the ongoing themes that I think in regards to their forecast. But later on this evening, we'll be watching employment figures out of Australia, looking for a 7.2% increase compared to that 16.5K read that we saw last time around. Unemployment rate, however, expected to uptick to 3.9 from 3.7. And then tomorrow, initial jobs claims out of the U.S., but again, more Fed officials on the wires, Governor Bowman on the wires, New York Fed President, permanent voting member on the FOMC, John Williams, will be also on the wires early in the morning here in the U.S. And then we also have Atlanta Fed President Rafael Bostic on the wires. He'll be speaking twice tomorrow, actually. And then we'll be watching inflation numbers coming out of Japan. And to wrap up the week, we have U.K. retail sales along with Chicago Fed President Mr. Austin Goolsbee. So more Fed officials on the wires as you go into the end of the week. And just a quick preview before we meet again next week. Early on, we'll be watching a lot of purchasing managers' indices. We'll be watching that coming out of the Euro area, the UK, as well as the US. And just remember with these PMI figures, 50 is the make it or break it line. So anything above 50 highlights or suggests expansion for that sector, below 50 contraction, right? And then we have inflation numbers coming out of Australia next week. And then before we meet, before our session, retail sales out of Switzerland, US durable goods orders, and especially following the better than expected US retail sales numbers that we saw just during the last few days, we'll see if the US, the strong consumer, will continue to be a theme for the US to watch. But just quickly in regards to the IMF numbers, if you didn't see the breakdown, and again, if you watch the headlines, the US is now expected to grow more than double its other major G7 counterparts. But if we look at the revisions, and this is what I want to cover real quickly, we've seen the IMF continue to boost the economic forecast, the growth forecast for the US. So compared to the January update, 2024, they upped it by 0.6%. But here's the theme that I want to talk about, where Europe, they continue to cut the GDP forecast for Europe. UK, same story. Canada, also a down revision there. However, Japan, holding steady. So just, again, take that for what it's worth, guys. But Japan didn't really see any revisions. As a matter of fact, if we look forward, 2025, we've seen the IMF actually up the GDP forecast for Japan. So we do have the BOJ next week. We'll see whether or not we get any sort of meaningful things to watch ahead of them, especially where dollar yen is trading. But with where we are, and we'll quickly start off with euro dollar, following the CPI report last week, where again, we saw the numbers coming stronger than expected, we've seen dollar strength. Along with that, long-term US Treasury yields have been on the rise. But right now, if you were here for last week's session, we had that monthly opening range just ahead of the CPI. That was sort of my line in the sand, if you will, whether or not we were going to see a topside break or if we were going to fail to defend the low that we carved out during the first couple of days of April. We got that break higher just ahead of CPI, but the levels that I was watching, 108 into that 108.60 into that 108.80 zone, we gut checked it at the start of the month or earlier in the month, first week. Just had a CPI, we failed to break and close above there. And then we had CPI following that report, failed to defend the monthly low. And right now, I think we're sitting at a key juncture here. So the level that I'm watching right now, 106.10, 106.40, and we're just pretty much a stone throws away from those November lows. So given where we are, one thing I do like to do is do a top-down sort of analysis to get a sense of, are we seeing anything more meaningful, maybe on the intraday chart. So right now, in terms of price action itself, euro dollar no longer carving lower highs and lower lows. So we'll see whether or not is euro in for a rebound. And especially if we look at the RSI signature here, we saw that move towards oversold. However, we have yet to get that oversold signal here. And again, we haven't seen one in euro dollar since September. Looks as though, are we seeing RSI get a bit of a turn as euro dollar no longer carves out this bearish price series? So from here, to get a better sense, you know, again, as I mentioned, the top-down analysis, you know, I'll go down to the 4-hour as it's sitting at a key level that I've been watching, again, 106.10, 106.40. And if we look at the RSI signature here on the 4-hour time frame, we saw this one actually push into oversold territory. It was holding below that for, again, since the start of the week, or carried over from last week. But even as we've seen euro dollar register fresh monthly lows this week, just yesterday, on the 4-hour, we actually got a buy signal, the textbook buy signal on the RSI signature, where again, RSI moved above 30. If you want to call this the start of a divergence, feel free to do that. Again, at this point, my take is as good as yours, but given where we are in terms of levels, what I'm seeing on the 4-hour time frame is the start of a divergence on the RSI signature, as again, even though we saw fresh monthly lows here, RSI no longer reflecting that extreme reading that we saw carried over from Friday, right? So take that for what it's worth. But you know, given where we are, we'll see whether or not we'll attempt to retrace the decline from the monthly high. But if we continue to close above 106.10, 106.40. Maybe this will turn out to just be a failed attempt to test those November lows. So from here, it looks as though we're trying to take out the highs from yesterday. So again, looks as though we're trying to break out of the bearish price area. So if we do see a rebound, first initial region of interest, I'll be watching again, former support. So potentially the February lows where we carved out the yearly lows just early on in the year. I'll be watching that. But above the February lows, I have 107.70, just a 32 retracement. And then above there, this zone, 108.60 into that 108.80 zone, not too far off of those monthly highs. But another thing that I'm watching right now is also these moving averages. We've seen the 50-day moving average here in green develop that negative slope. So even before the monthly highs, we'll see whether or not we get a response to that 50-day moving average there. But I'll be keeping a close eye on some of these moving averages, especially for some of the other pairs. But in regards to what materialized following CPI, failed to defend the monthly low. But right now, ahead of the November lows, there's a level that I'm watching or zone that I'm watching, 106.10, 106.40. We'll see whether or not RSI will continue to hold above or stay out of oversold territory, given that, again, we've seen Eurodollar no longer carve out lower highs and lower lows. And again, if we look at the 4-hour time frame, are we starting to see a bit of divergence with RSI versus price, right? With that, let's jump quickly to cable. Similar to Eurodollar, I was watching the monthly opening range. Similar story here, following US CPI last week, failed to defend the monthly lows. And we've taken out some interesting levels here, failed to defend the February low. So kind of like Euro, we're trading at fresh yearly lows here. But even with this one, when I take a look at the RSI signature here, it looked as though we could have potentially gotten the first oversold reading for this year, but again, hasn't happened. And when we take a look at the levels, I have 123.90 below that. I mean, we're quite far away from the November lows, unlike Euro, but you know, Euro is just a stone throws away from testing those November lows. Cable a little bit further, but remember, this is just coming off of after we carved out fresh yearly highs during the previous month. So we'll see again how cable will fare, especially with BOE Governor Andrew Bailey on the wires later on this afternoon. But if I take the same approach here as I did with Euro, when I take a look at the 4-hour time frame and the RSI signature here, again, oversold reading last week, but even when we compare this with Euro, we saw this RSI signature on the 4-hour time frame move out of oversold faster than what we're seeing in Euro. So we'll see whether or not we'll continue to see potential divergence here. But even though we've seen fresh yearly lows in the exchange rate this week, 4-hour time frame RSI moving away from oversold territory. So, you know, is this a signal of potential exhaustion? And even when you take a look at the daily, are we seeing the RSI hold above 30 as we're seeing this bit of rebound here? So in terms of price action, Eurodollar had lower highs, lower lows. Cable wasn't as clean, but the price levels that I watch for cable, first, I have 124.70. We've been trying to get back above there since the start of the week. I would like to see a close above there for a little bit more of a meaningful bounce in the exchange rate. First region, I have 200-day moving average here in red. But in terms of Fibonacci's, I have 126.30 coming into play above there, monthly highs, 50-day moving average there as well. With this one, I would say, again, I have to be mindful of what happened earlier this year where it did register fresh yearly highs in March. It was the only one to do that. So with this one, you know, I'm more flat than anything. We'll see how price action will fare, especially going into the close of today. Again, if we see a close back above 124.70, I'll look for a further rebound here. And again, in terms of the downside, looks as though we're seeing a bit of an exhaustion, especially when we take a look at the RSI signatures. But 123.90, if we do see cable take that out, then I have 123 into that 123.20 zone. And then below that, I have the November lows coming into play, right? But again, cable may be faring better than its other major counterparts as it's still holding or quite far away from testing those November lows. But when we take a look at some of these other pairs like Aussie, with this one, same thing with Euro. Euro not too far off of testing those November lows. However, similar to Euro, I have a zone that I'm watching, 63.80 into that 64.10 zone, right? We'll see if that'll be a key caveat to watch. Again, this one, in terms of the RSI signature, further away from oversold, but again, even if we take a look at the four-hour signature, we actually saw the RSI push into oversold this week, but it's coming out of that. And again, we'll see how things will materialize, especially with the slew of Fed officials on the wires this week. But for now, as we're seeing Aussie dollar hold above 63.80, 64.10. One thing I want to see, kind of like Euro, not only is it no longer making new lows, but I want to see it take out yesterday's high to break out of this bearish price series. So if it does do that, first level that I have, 65.10, 65.20. But in terms of Aussie, remember, I would argue that I think last year, one of the themes that I was watching were European exchange rates were faring better than some of the Asia PAC currencies, whether you want to blame that on some of the concerns surrounding China, Australia's largest, biggest trading partner. But, you know, historically, we've seen interest rates in Australia higher. But remember, right now, Australia interest rates are 4.35 compared to, you know, the Fed, who's at 5.25%, 5.5%. So, you know, we'll see how things will fare going forward. But, you know, with that, let's just quickly, you know, one thing I want to sort of bring up, as we do have a lot of Fed officials on the wires. Here's what I think is, again, here's some of the things that I'm watching right now as we're waiting to hear more out of the Fed. But if we take a look at what's materialized just over the last few days, and, you know, this is the CME Fed Watch tool, something I watch regularly to see where markets are in terms of where are U.S. interest rates headed. So quickly for May, I think these have been largely unchanged. So again, current threshold, 5.25%, 5.5%. Month ago, 93% chance, 94% chance the Fed was going to hold. As of today, 98. I mean, if you want to argue it's gotten stronger, feel free. But this is where it really starts to get interesting. June. Remember, the June is going to be the quarterly meeting. And remember, it is an election year. So the one, you know, theme that I think a lot of market participants are watching is, will the Fed deliver a rate cut ahead of the election, or are they going to wait till after? But if we look at what's materializing here for June, a month ago, 41% chance the Fed was going to hold. As of today, 80%. Right? So we, again, these numbers are prone to change, and that's why I watch these regularly. But again, 41% a month ago, now it's up to 80. And if we scroll all the way out to July, there was a 22% chance a month ago, now 56. And then if we look at the one just ahead of election, the quarterly meeting in September, this is where it gets really interesting. 7% chance a month ago, now it's all the above 30%. And again, these numbers are prone to change. We'll see how Fed officials will continue to guide us going forward, especially with the slew of officials on the wires. But, you know, looking forward, we have PCE next week. So in regards to that, the March numbers, here's the Fed's own forecast. This is from the Cleveland Fed's model, the inflation now casting model. But for the March read, 2.7% expected for core, 2.7% expected for headline, right? Rounding up or rounding the numbers. But here's the interesting thing for me, where if we look forward and we look at the Fed's own model and what they're projecting for April, which is again the month ahead, core, if we round up, 2.7, headline 2.6. So slight slowdown in headline is expected for the future, but core, no, I'm not too sure, right? If we round the numbers, suggestive that inflation, core PCE, which is often regarded as the Fed's preferred gauge for inflation, expected to hold steady, at least for March, and then even for the month ahead. So some of the things just to keep in the back of your mind, and along with that, if we look at how growth has been faring, this is the Atlanta Fed GDP Now model. So the latest update, which came out yesterday, the U.S. economy is now projected to grow 2.9% in the first quarter of this year. And this is upgraded from just the day before from 2.9%, right? So here's the graphic. This is the current sort of pickup that we're seeing, or the adjustment that we're seeing in the Fed's own GDP model. And we'll see if this will be a theme to watch now that the U.S. economy is expected to grow close to 3%. In the first quarter of this year. So a lot of things to take in. With that, we'll see if the U.S. dollar strength story will persist. But again, when we take a look at where we are in terms of some of these levels, and especially when we take a look at do this sort of top-down approach, again, even when we take a look at Aussie, is there a slight divergence starting to happen with the momentum indicator, the RSI here? And is that going to be something to watch, especially going into some of these event risks? So Kiwi, bullish outside day engulfing if you look at candlestick patterns. But you know, even with this one, no longer carving lower highs and lower lows. I mean, it made a lower low, but it took out the high from yesterday. Same story here. If we look at the 4 hour, you know, are we seeing a bit of exhaustion on this time frame? As we did see, again, oversold reading, but now it kicked above 30. We'll see, you know, what's going to materialize, especially with Fed officials on the wires. But in terms of levels, if we're even with this one quickly, kind of like euro, not too far from those November low. So did we see euro cable, maybe some of these exchange rates here, fail to test those November lows? Bit of exhaustion, especially if you look at the 4 hour time frame, RSI. So for Kiwi dollar, 59.10, 59.60, I know it's sort of a big zone. I would need to see a close above there for a little bit more of a meaningful retracement here off from the monthly highs. But the level wise, I have a lot converging here on the in terms of the moving averages, just right around that 60-70 zone, just a longer dating extension. But here's something I'm watching specifically for Kiwi. Actually, let's go back to Aussie real quickly, because maybe not the clear signal, but one thing I have been watching is these moving averages, the 50 and 200 day moving average. Not only are they, I think, reflecting a negative slope, but they're starting to converge. But the one that's a little bit cleaner, at least in my view, is what's happening with Kiwi dollar, where negative slope here in the 50 day moving average, negative slope here in the 200 day moving average. So if we do see these cross over, for me, that would signal a death cross, right? Because we're seeing the moving averages cross over when they have similar slope, right? We don't want to see this like an X formation, right? I would call this a false crossover. Some might call this a golden cross, but I mean, if you took this as a bullish signal, look at what happened the days after, right? So just be mindful. That's how I look at these moving averages. And you know, for me to have a meaningful signal from these crossovers, they need to happen when they have similar slopes. So something I'm keeping a close eye on Kiwi dollar here. But if it struggles here, again, downside, November lows below there, last year's low. And then in terms of levels, I have 5740 into that 5760 zone. Quickly, dollar cat. Fresh yearly highs. However, even with this one, is it struggling just ahead of those November highs? On the daily, though, we actually had an overbought reading on this RSI signature. So not sure if there's a divergence. However, are we going to get that textbook sell signal when RSI moves below 70? So I'll keep that on the radar there. And quickly, if we look at the 4 hour time frame and on the RSI here, we're seeing sort of a double whammy, overbought reading Friday, kickback at the start of the week. And now we're seeing it struggle to hold above 70. So I'll wait for the daily for a little bit more confirmation on whether or not, you know, we're getting these meaningful signals on the RSI signature here. But in terms of levels, again, is it just failure to hold or test the November highs as it's strung to hold above 138.10 region here? Again, maybe I'm jumping the gun here, but if it is actually struggling here, if we do get the textbook sell signal on the RSI signature, maybe it could be a good time to start taking some new reference point. And for that, I am going to use, you know, when I use Fibonacci's, not only am I looking at some of these reference points, but I also like to take time into consideration. So January low, right, the yearly range, if we take a look at that, I'll again keep a close on some of the trend lines that I have on my charts, the positive slope here on the 50-day moving average. But in terms of, if we just take a quick retracement of the year-to-date range, right, the 23.6 comes in right around 37. Be something interesting to watch, but the Fibonacci's here not too far from some of the levels that I have already on my chart, so I'm not going to leave it on there yet, but we'll see if that will be appropriate over the coming days, especially if we do get that sell signal on the RSA signature. Even with this one failing to extend the series of higher highs, but with everything else, I would need to see the break of the low here, yesterday's low, for a little bit more conviction there, right below there. I'll watch channel resistance to see if that's going to offer some support. But in terms of levels, 136.30, sort of former resistance. I mean, if you want to line up the December highs as like the former resistance zone, we'll see if that will be something to watch. But for now, I'll wait for the RSI signature to see if the daily, will show that move below 70. So dollar CAD, I think, kind of interesting here going into some of these event risks. And last but not least, I know I always save these yen pairs for last. So with the BOJ, they're up next week. And let me just reference again, I feel like we have some new viewers here. IMF boosted the forecast for the US, but they also kept Japan stable after downgrading Europe, the UK, Canada as well for this year. So, you know, if I was on the BOJ, even when the IMF is telling me that, hey, guess what, your economy is not going to do too bad. So for this year, Japan is expected to go just right around 1%. Not too bad. You know, does that really, you know, sort of, is that going to be something that's going to keep the BOJ on the sidelines? I mean, at this point, my guess is as good as yours on whether or not Japanese authorities are going to intervene. But with dollar yen overbought reading on RSI signature, keep a close eye on that. And remember, we haven't seen, this is the first one this year. And in terms of just the magnitude, the last one we had was the summer months of last year. But in terms of magnitude, we haven't seen one like this since back in 2022, right? So just a bit of caution here. In terms of price series, it's pretty much flat on the day. But with this one, just quickly, we'll see how U.S. yields will fare. Even with this, this is U.S. 10-year yield. We got these slight overbought reading on the RSI signature for U.S. Treasuries, but struggling there, right? So keep a close eye on dollar yen. We'll see how yields will fare. But in terms of levels, I have 155, and then I have the June 1990 high coming in at 155.80, right? So as long as the RSI is above 70, this is a trend that I don't want to fight. So those are some of the levels that I'll watch. And even if, when and if we do see the pullback in dollar yen, I'm just going to look for, again, some of these things that we learn, right? Former resistance, is that going to offer new support? So for that, November highs, last year's highs, if you want to line up the highs from back in March, feel free. But 2022 highs, July 1990 high. So the region that I have, 151.95 into that 152.25, right? But again, not sure if we're there yet to look for a pullback, given the extreme reading that we're seeing in the RSI signature. And even if we do a top down on this one, if you look at the 4 hour, man, just holding above 70 here. We'll see if that will continue to be the case on the 4 hour time frame as well, as we do have, again, lots of Fed officials on the wires. So with dollar yen, 155 above there, I have the June 1990 high, and then just some extensions above there, 156.50 into that 157.10 region. But not only am I watching these yen pairs, and as we're seeing some weakness, or maybe I should argue strength, in these other major exchange rates, like the rebound we're seeing in euro, like what we're seeing in the British pound, this is where some of these yen crosses are going to be interesting. Where are we going to see some yen weakness being portrayed through some of these crosses? So pound yen, last week we saw that bit of gut check, right, with the 50-day moving average, which continues to reflect the positive slope there. So did we see a mere gut check of the slope there? And right now we're just approaching the monthly highs. So if it takes that out, yearly highs that we carved out or registered last month. But I have a zone that I'm watching, 192.40 into that 193.50 area. Not only would I want to see a breach above there, but I need a close price above there, which it failed to do last month, for a little bit more conviction on this one. And then I have some historical price to watch above there if it does clear that. The August 2015 high comes in right around 195.28. So with pound yen, have we seen, again, just a gut check of the positive slope in the 50-day moving average? It's approaching the monthly highs. If it takes that out, we have the yearly highs from last month. So I'll be keeping a close eye on this one, given where it's sitting. And even if we take a look at pairs like Aussie yen, similar story with pound yen, where we continue to see that positive slope there. Maybe not as dynamic as pound yen, as it's still a bit far from the monthly high. But, you know, with this one, Aussie yen carved out or registered fresh yearly highs earlier this month before we got this sort of pullback. And with this one, I have the 2022 high 98.77. I mean, whether you want to call that form of resistance or highs from last year, sort of form of resistance, but are we seeing that sort of textbook play? Is form of resistance offering some new support? Are we going to see Aussie yen continue to hold above the 50-day moving average there? And are we going to see a bit of response to that, right? So I think Aussie yen, again, even though it's not as dynamic as pound yen, still a bit far from those monthly highs. I think it's doing a pretty good job of defending the zone. Again, I have the 2022 high, 98.77 in terms of levels, 99, 618 Fibonacci extension. We'll see if it'll continue close above there, manage to hold above the 50-day moving average, and we'll see if it'll try to, you know, track some of these slopes. But, excuse me, very interesting developments, I think, not just with dollar yen, but with some of these other yen crosses. And with that, just quickly, gold. You know, we're over on time, guys, but gold, another theme I don't want to fight. Man, this overbought reading here, my guess is as good as yours on when this thing is going to finally cross below 70, but don't fight it. That's my theme. So from here, levels, I mean, we're in uncharted territory, so my guess is as good as yours. But in terms of extensions, I have 2396 above there. I don't have anything until 2517, let's call it. Just the 1618 extension. But with this one, again, uncharted territory at this point. You know, watch some of these round figures, but don't fight the trend, given that we continue to see, you know, this very extreme reading in the RSI signature. And quickly, oil. Looks like we're getting a bit of pullback here, but the one thing that I want to mention as I'm watching Kiwi dollar, specifically the moving averages there, as the 50 approaches the 200-day, oil. I'm scratching my head over on whether or not I want to call this a golden cross, because again, similar slope, right? Positive slope, and we got the crossover. And then we got the overbought reading on the RSI. First one this year, right? Didn't last, like, you know, in terms of what we saw last year, but again, we saw the break of the range, fresh yearly highs. Is this just a mere pullback in the broader scheme of things? As we're seeing, again, positive slope there, positive slope in the 200-day moving average. Is this a golden cross that we've just, you know, sort of seen in oil? And all this to say, especially given, you know, my sort of focus on macroeconomics, what is higher oil prices going to do, you know, for these central banks, right? And especially with dollar strength, I'm sure some of these emerging markets and, you know, these net importers of oil, energy, you know, I feel as though they might get a double whammy, especially for economies like Japan, right? Who is a net importer of oil, you know, with exchange rates like this, if we continue to see a rise in oil, you know, what is that going to mean for not only monetary policy outlook, but, you know, are we going to get a bit of response from these central banks, right? With that, guys, I hope everyone enjoyed today's overview. I hope to see you all again next week to do this all over again. But until then, guys, the best of luck on all your trades.